like if I had extra time, I would do them before the lectures even, like.
Or do them in the lecture, so I have.
Yeah.
If I was able to.
That's hard though, cause she's a fast talker, and it's, I don't know. For me, I just would like write. I wouldn't even think about it. Write it as.
For the end though, she usually gets like she does. Like, she'll talk so fast, so fast, and she has so few left that they're like one for the lecture.
I'm gonna start right off with Rousseau. I should tie him in somewhat to the shooting in Florida. It would be wrong not to mention the shooting in Florida yesterday.
Did you hear about that? I heard someone say something about a tragedy, and I.
Yeah, there was another school shooting, 17.
Yeah, 17.
So we have another, he was captured, but I mean it was another one of those situations where he was publishing all sorts of things on social media that should have tipped people off. They did actually kick him out of the school, or they didn't say what. That's of course private, but at the same time you think, gosh, if they had that much reason to be upset with him, and they knew he had guns. Had posted pictures of his armory.
How old is this kid?
19.
Oh, 19.
So I guess he is legally allowed to own guns, isn't he?
Yes.
That's what like a lot of the controversy is about, is like the fact that he had such like easy access to it, and he was very obviously unstable, like very obviously unstable.
Was he living with his parents or something?
No,
parents have both died.
Yeah.
And they were the adoptive parents.
Yeah, I know.
And so,
I read about his,
you know, he and his brother were adopted, and then the father died, and then shortly after that, the mother died.
Oh man, that poor kid.
And he was living with, I guess, a family that took them in. Even so, they knew he had a gun that was in the gun safe in the house.
Was it like a semi-automatic?
It's an AR-15.
What is that?
Automatic rifle, or whatever the AR stands for. It's basically a military weapon.
Aren't those illegal?
It was, up until 2006, and then they let that bill elapse. And so now it's legal again. Over 1.5 million guns were sold last year. Well, not just those.
You get tricky into what is an assault rifle. AR-15, only semi-automatic.
Okay.
The difference between that and like the military version, which would be the M4, and they look almost identical, is the fact that the M4 has the 3-round burst, and the AR-15 does not. It's only the single round.
Right.
Well, the only tie-in I could think of that's easiest, I guess, is that Rousseau's political philosophy was behind some of those inspired. French Revolution, the 1789 French Revolution, that ended up in the Terror, with Madame Guillotine chopping heads off, including those of Robespierre himself, who was like.
That guy was off
the French have quite the history of violent revolution, if I remember correctly.
They're like, oh,
hey,
the Americans did it, let's now create this thing, and just chop all their.
Why was the French Revolution such a mess compared to, well, theoretically we could argue, and this is, I think, a good interpretation of this, a good model to hold for this, is that our so-called revolution was not a revolution. It was a war of independence. Because the elite members of the colonies wanted to divorce themselves from the control of the home state and succeeded in doing that. So it wasn't really a revolution in the sense that it changed the status quo. The status quo in the colonies remained who they were, but they divorced themselves from primarily the fiscal attachment.
Well, do you know the definition of revolution? I'll look it up.
Well, literally it means this.
A forcible overthrow of a government or social order in favor of a new system.
And they didn't really.
Not new really, ruler no. Or new yeah. People in control of it.
Didn't they just replace another monarch?
Oh, the French?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought we
were just... Oh, no, the French Revolution was a total revolution and failed miserably because of this guy's thinking. And why? Also, so what I tried to show you first was so number one, he starts off as a composer. So these two pieces that I've been playing, the first one, this is from the Daphne and Chloe overture, and the previous one was from his opera. So this is. But in any case, I'd have to look up Devin in French. But so what's neat about him is he's a mildly successful composer, but he talks to a friend of his, Voltaire, who we really ought to do a lot more with. And it's kind of interesting stuff between them, too, because there are some people that think Voltaire and he did not like one another. But actually, if you read their letters, which, how many people have done that? But guess what? If you read their letters, it looks to me like the kind of letters two friends would write to one another that are being ironically critical of one another. But they write enough that it's like they're glad to write to one another to say those things, but they're being smart with one another. And so I read that as these guys are friends and mutually, mostly influential from Voltaire to Rousseau. And Rousseau basically asks, how do I become famous? Did I tell you this already?
No.
And Voltaire says, all you have to do is write books that say exactly the opposite of what everybody believes to be true. And so Voltaire, I forget which one, I think it was it might have been the one on education, he writes, says, the best education is no education. Let the kids grow up naturally and kick them out of the house once they're weaned, basically. Let them survive in the street. It's total nonsense, right? You know, and any that survive and get curious and ask you questions, right, this is a meal, right? You know, then answer their questions, right? So let them kind of be their own guide. So it's student-centered education.
It's like
right?
The non-schoolers, I think, talk in their movement now.
Oh,
scholars.
Oh. It's because they read him and they don't realize this was a joke.
He wanted to be famous.
He wanted to be famous, and he became famous like overnight because everyone thought, oh, what a wonderful philosophy of education. You know, it was just totally opposite of what everyone knew already to be the case.
You should write a book. How
and he's still famous.
The
you still have to read this stuff if you're getting your degree in education. Because that's like, oh, that's wonderful. That's student-centered. Let them.
Sounds good.
But, the same thing with... politics. The best government? No government. No government's the best government. Government corrupts. Civilization is what corrupts people. Out in nature, we're... You know, the ideal native kind of you know, thing. You know, so where did that come from? You know, and by the way, that's totally wrong. When we look, I think one of the best references to this, I think I've mentioned Steven Pinker, The Better Angels of Our Nature, right? You know, you look at the data they have, and we're living in the best society now ever.
Yeah.
And you go back and you look at, and there are graphs that show you how many people were being killed violently.
Yeah, there's so much intertribal warfare that people don't like talk about because they have this like super skewed view of things.
Even here, you know, when you get into it, the natives here know that there were wars between the tribes here, and lots of villages were totally wiped out by one another. So these folks, you know, that, you know, have this idealization of what native culture is and how it beautifully coexists with nature, that's totally wrong.
Yeah.
One of the reasons that Native Americans weren't able to fight off or to keep their lands from Europeans other than disease and guns was that they didn't band together. Because there was so much.
Actually, they banded with the whites to fight against their traditional enemies.
Yeah, exactly. And then they were betrayed and stuck on reservations.
A lot of those, original like Native American colonies, are like now that they're like looking at it, most of them like are classified as like anarcho-communism societies. That's like basically what they are.
Gosh, and I'm the one that's teaching you guys. You guys should. Be the one conducting this class.
You see, now bury my heart that wounded me. Actually,
the author. That wasn't Vine Deloria, was it?
I'm not sure.
He's a really great author. I'm trying to remember. He has one on that. He is dead. He died 2005. Did you see it?
Where did it go?
None of these.
Brown.
Oh, okay. Because he did write something that this God Is Red is a very philosophical, excellent book. Custer Died for Your Sins. That's the one I was thinking of. Sorry. It's a different one. So, operas, he wrote. What else? So let's take a look at Wiki States. 1778, 66 years. And so what kinds of things? So he's influenced, of course, by the philosophers of his time. And he's going to have a terrific influence on them. There's Emile on education. The New Heloise, notice, So these are all important books. The Social Contract. Now, we've talked about The Social Contract with Hobbes. We've talked about it with Locke and Jefferson. Rousseau is one of the other major players in this. But suggested with the fact of the terror resulting from his version of the social contract. His version of the social contract is a dismal failure. No one wants to try it. That's basically anarchic in nature, because there's no opportunity for structure. It's like everybody gets to vote, but there's no structure of how that works, right? So it fell apart, basically. And you end up with a rapid slip into totalitarianism with the strong man. And in that case, it turned out to be Napoleon.
Right.
So, but yes, he was the most popular of the Jacobin Club, who were the ones that basically led that revolution. So a national hero, and buried in the Pantheon in Paris. But my main suggestion here is, if you think of his philosophy as a joke, really, was it that I couldn't, you know, think that seriously and write the stuff he did? But in a sense, it was inspiring because it was so totally different than what everyone had already thought. So the view that all legitimacy comes from the individuals, that's part of it. So you know, no legitimacy to a top-down authoritarian regime. Education, again, you know, the idea that letting the child grow naturally, as if there's something wonderful about that. And that the idea of the individual in nature is the best, right? And that civilization corrupts. So that's totally wrong. We know that today, that it's backwards, but there it is. The odd thing with religion is that he seems to be the individual that encouraged people in the Christian faith, I might be wrong about this, but encouraged people in the Christian faith to think that the church ought to be interested in an improved life here and now of the Christian population.
Instead of just focusing on the afterlife.
On the afterlife, on the soul, right? So if you look at there was already this conflict in the church because, of course, human beings are the people running the church. And you have individuals that are basically saint-like in the theological perspective of the church, where they feel like an aesthetic life is the best life. They should not have attachment to physical reality. So that no wealth should accumulate and all that sort of thing. Sacrifice for everyone else. But you know, basically, starve yourself. That's good for the soul. You know, wear a really itchy shirt.
Why? Self-discipline is a big factor.
Yeah, I was reading about Anselm, Saint Anselm, and when he was murdered in the cathedral, Becket, Thomas Becket, was murdered in the cathedral, and when they were taking care of the body, they realized that he had a rough shirt underneath, like a horsehair shirt or something. It's instead of, you know, like a nice silk shirt or something that would be comfortable, he wore something that would be scratchy and miserable.
For God?
Right. To torture himself as a sacrifice, right?
I guess that's like kind of respectable though, like. I don't know, like, I used to just, like, kind of be like, Christianity is just a whole bunch of nonsense, but, like, some of the, like, philosophies on, like, self-discipline are really impressive, like the whole Job thing, like, that's some devotion.
Oh, you know what, it wasn't on Wikipedia, it might not be in Wikipedia, it was on the church, so, at the Advent Rousseau is the one that, that feels like, you know, what the church has been doing is, you know, accumulating all this wealth, when what they should do is share it with everyone. You know, so, so help out, you know, their people. And so kind of the more modern day feel that the church ought to be doing stuff to help the physical life of the world. It's kind of a Rousseau revolt against what the church was actually for. So what other things can I think of that? So his music was contemporary, though. So he didn't revolt in his musical style. At the time, he was pretty popular. But that's when he fell in with Voltaire and wanted to know how he could become popular. And Voltaire encouraged him to be an author. So that's kind of... You really could do a whole lot more, of course, on Rousseau. And not everyone would agree, by the way, with that interpretation of it. But that's like my spark notes. cheap way of thinking about So did you have any questions on So this is an old French movie.
Professor Emmanuel Kant.
Oui, c'est ici.
So this is when he's old. He's not dying yet.
Je vous imaginez plus petit. J'espère que mon écran sera assez grand, professeur.
Pardon?
J'espère que mon écran sera assez grand.
Oui, certainement.
Vous êtes optimiste, mais vous savez, parfois, on les fait se baisser. C'est beaucoup moins inquiet, évidemment. Dites donc, heureusement que je ne travaille plus à l'ancienne. Où comptez-vous m'installer? Pas ici, je suppose. Je pensais qu'il vous serait agréable d'exercer votre art
dans le bureau.
Très bien. Un professeur dans son bureau, ça va être un chic.
Par ici, s'il vous plaît.
Neither of them. That's his butler, and that's a painter who's there to do a portrait.
Vous êtes un connaisseur? Belle silhouette. En pied, grandeur nature, c'est un Gutmann. Oui, c'est signé Gutmann, n'est-ce pas?
Pardon?
C'est...
That was common.
S'il vous plaît, monsieur. Pas du tout.
Kant's on the
c'est
other side of the screen. You see.
Comment arrêter cette tour? Respirer la bouche ouverte irrite la trachée et excite la tour. Nul besoin de médication. Une opération mentale immédiate suffira. Détournons l'attention, concentrons-la sur n'importe quel objet. Détournons l'attention, concentrons-la. Détournons, concentrons. Détournons, concentrons. En même temps, freinons l'expiration de l'air. Irritons ainsi la trachée et excitons la salive par la même irritation. Freinons l'expiration, irritons la trachée, excitons la salive. Cette opération exige un très haut degré de fermeté dans la résolution et par la même engendre d'autres.
Every day at the same time he would go for a walk. In the park. He would just go back and forth in this one spot, I think four times, five times, whatever. It was always the same amount. So his routine through the day was incredibly precise. And this video shows how that. Bell rings.
Monsieur le professeur, voici l'heure.
In fact, the townspeople set their clocks by. Time clocks weren't very good. Butler had to have the coffee exactly right, the paper exactly right.
And I guess you always know what they want.
Everything was exactly the same every day, and it was like the same gruel or something.
Le café.
Monsieur le professeur. Voici le café.
Watch how he drinks it.
Guess it does cool it off faster though, so like, kind of makes sense.
And he's done. Same exact routine every single day.
Does he actually like that?
Yes, apparently.
Maybe OCD.
He's probably had all of these, I don't know.
Yeah, he's probably, maybe he was on the spectrum, so maybe it made him uncomfortable to not do the same.
Butler ends up getting married, and he fires him because that's a change.
Wow, that's a terrible lawyer.
Oh yeah, kind of like.
What? The guy just stuck to your stupid rules, man.
He didn't marry. He didn't marry her, did you?
Monsieur le professeur. professeur, voici le journal de Hartmann.
Quoi? Qu'est-ce que vous dites? Ne vous l'ai-je déjà pas dit que ce n'est pas Hartmann, mais Hartung?
You made a mistake.
Allons, répétez après moi. Pas Hartmann, mais Hartung.
Pas Hartmann, mais Hartung.
Encore.
Pas Hartmann, mais Hartung.
Encore une fois.
Pas Hartmann, mais Hartung.
Throw
them
off schedule.
Is this worth showing you? Is this interesting?
Yeah, I love French.
Fascinating.
It's cool that it's all on YouTube. He like sneezed in French.
Your
did you hear that? That was such a French sneeze. That's
where he goes on his walk. He fell down once, and it took a while for people to discover him and pick him up. And then he kept walking. Oh, and he always had, even rain or shine, the butler always had to have the umbrella just in case.
Then you can't be thrown off schedule.
They know what time it is because of.
It's a very obvious sign.
Where you go? What time? Is any of you there?
There if you want to watch it. So that's, you saw how easy it was to find, although maybe Google already knows what I'm looking for, I don't know.
Does this movie go into like the history of Kant a lot, or is it mostly just like his daily life?
It's just until he dies. This is Königsberg at the time had an island in the middle of the river, and it was connected to another island by one bridge, and the two of them to the sides of the river by each of them a number of bridges. And it was a puzzle. Is there some way that you could walk once across every single bridge without walking across any of the other ones? And the answer is no. And by the way, the bridges are gone now. Like four of them were blown up in World War II and et cetera. So if you're curious.
Wonder what he did if something really did go wrong.
So, what do we think about Kant? Is it still on?
Some weird background noise.
I think somebody's shoveling.
Oh, it is.
It's an unmistakable sound.
So.
He was born in. He's a Russian guy?
No. So, yeah, it's in Poland now, I believe. Yeah, I think that's correct. Oh, is it Russia now? It was Poland for a while, I thought. But it was part of Prussia. Prussia was a German country, so it was a German state at the time. So he dies age 79. And the main claim to fame is his three main books. Well, there's a couple others that are also very important, but the three main books are the critique of pure reason, the critique of practical reason, and the critique of judgment. So the three critiques, and those were all, I believe, from like the 1780s. And he wrote them. Let's see if I can. But if you're another very important article, the one that you would most likely see the most is What is Enlightenment? Auf Deutsch, was ist Aufklärung? Clearing up. So, here's the 1787 is the first of the critiques, the critique of pure reason, the critique of practical reason the next year, and critique of judgment. So these are all books that he wrote after he read David Hume's treatise, which woke him from his rationalist slumbers, right? So he was a typical German rationalist following the works of Christian Wolff, who was a follower of Leibniz at the time that he read David Hume. And he realized, oh, David Hume is right. And so he begins with the critique of pure reason. People had trouble reading that, so he revised a part of it, and it became the prolegomena, which means before you read the other thing, prolegomena, read this first, which was an attempt to make it easier for his colleagues to understand what he was trying to do.
When talking about how he expanded on Hume's idea and like worked on like solving the problem, what was that problem again? Like, I know a basis of it, but like what like clearly was Hume's thing that Kant tried to help?
Right. So let me draw. So the problem is the empiricist realized that all you really know for sure is what you're experiencing at the moment. So you can't trust your memory, so that shows causality. It's no longer a necessary connection. It's more a matter of our memories that give us the sense that something is connected. So all we're aware of is phenomena, which is literally the Greek word for phenomena, or phane, really, is a lantern. So if you can imagine what this sort of, as a metaphor, showing is that when you're, like if you're walking around in the dark, you've got a flashlight.
You don't know what's ahead, you don't know what's behind you, you can only focus on what's being.
Everything that you can be be aware of is what your own light shines on. Right? So yeah, you can't see behind, you can't see all around you. You can only see what you yourself shine your light on. In other words, our senses. Our senses are our flashlight, right? It's what we show our senses on, that's what we can observe. Right? So that's what a phenomenon is.
So what's the problem with that?
Well, the problem with that is that means that we're not actually seeing the objects in themselves.
Oh, so he's wondering what things are actually like.
Yeah. So we end up with something out here, which in German is das Ding, on, that's A-N, see? So that's a famous and technical phrase that's neat to know if we look it up. And by the way, I've actually met Germans who never studied philosophy in German, and when I mentioned das Ding an sich, they think that's incorrect. Because in other situations, they don't refer to things as an sich. So this is a kind of a technical phrase in German philosophy. So that's kind of interesting. But so that's the thing in itself, which actually comes from Locke, as far as I know. Although there are other folks that say that it's introduced, concept introduced by Immanuel Kant. But I believe it comes from the British empiricists. So I might criticize Wikipedia here. Although Wiki's just reproducing what a lot of people say. So that seems to be the norm, that they say that Locke didn't think of the thing in itself. But that was the foundation of the empirical problem.
What is the thing in itself? What does that mean?
The object apart from the way my perceptions show.
Oh.
Right. So I see things, I hear, I have all my perceptions, say, associated with the coolness of this mug, with, I suppose, the containment of the water that's also, I don't know why I'm so thirsty today, but this is nice. I don't think so. However, so it was a freebie thing in my memory. I have all these, because I got it from Vine for free. It leaks. It's great with coffee. When I put hot coffee in it, and I put this on here, and then I drink from it, no leaks. But when there's water, and I drink from it, it dribbles. So it's something to do with the seal was made for hot fluids, not for cold ones.
How does it even work? How would that make it?
I don't know, but it does. It does not dribble. When I, yeah, see, even if I have it closed, it was closed. Now it's open. But with hot coffee, it doesn't do that.
This is probably good because coffee's hard to clean up.
I suppose.
What if it's cold coffee?
I bet it would leak.
That's a good experiment.
But the thing is, I've put like hot coffee in there in the morning. 8 hours later, it's still hot. So that's pretty weird. But so all of those characteristics that I think of, the shape and everything else, those are all things that my senses are interpreting, right? So I have phenomena. But would you agree, and if you're a follower of Locke, you agree that there's a physical object
that's interacting with my senses that's giving me all of that. I'm not, there's a big difference between this and this, right? So there's a real thing here. It's just that thanks to Locke and Berkeley and Hume, I don't know what the thing really is in itself,
like, what if we,
apart from how it seems to me.
Right. You can't see beyond like your, you know, flesh prison, so you can't really like interpret
right.
what it actually is.
But so, theoretically, even though I can't see, hear, taste, touch it, there's got to be this thing that I'm actually holding.
Or it could just be a weird simulation.
Well, so Locke is convinced that it's a real material thing. Berkeley argues, remember, that it's all in the mind of God, so it's really energy, which actually, if thinking in physicists' terms today, this is energy in an arrangement. There's no unchanging physical structure. There's a persistent, complex set of energy and an arrangement that's giving me the impression that there is.
So how did Kant try to solve this problem?
So, we also have a knower.
A knower?
The person that is knowing it. The experience is yours of what you're, right? So there's a self over here, an ego. But guess what? Hume and Berkeley both point out to us that you can't actually see that ego.
You're just interpreting it.
Right? You can't actually see yourself or know yourself. You know, I'm never aware of myself as an object for my own phenomena. You might agree with that or not. I don't know. I'm feeling my fingers. I'm feeling my thoughts. I'm remembering my memories and so on. Is that not phenomena that indicates me? Or, you know, what they will argue is that, no, you're experiencing all that phenomena, but there is no clear connection between that phenomena that kind of floods through my head like a wave of experience to any specific persistent object, and yet at the same time, theoretically, it has to be there. So the ego is outside of phenomena as well. The phenomena is just what I'm experiencing. And I hypothesize that there's a me that's experiencing that phenomena, and that the phenomena is this interaction between this ego and the objects that I'm experiencing. I can't see these, I can't see myself, all I experience is the phenomenon.
But we can't see it? Or just
well, no, we can't escape this dilemma. He agrees with you. So, that being the case, metaphysics, which all along has been an attempt to understand the ground of universe, the thing in itself, the ego, how all this works, all of that is part of metaphysics. And strictly speaking, he feels that Hume has proved that we cannot do metaphysics. And the argument goes this way. Oh, by the way, this is like a window. So Kant will give us categories of how the ego perceives phenomena, but it's not part of the phenomena, it's part of the ego. But let me do this argument first. This is his interpretation of Hume's argument, right? So we have a priori. What is a priori? It's just Latin for that which is prior to. But literally in Latin, it just means what's prior. Right? But so there's some historical interpretations of the a priori. For Aristotle, it just means the premises of an argument. And the conclusion is the a posteriori that would follow. Although, of course, Aristotle didn't speak Latin. So it's just the Latin translation of what he did use for that. But so what is assumed a priori? A priori for Hume and for Kant is knowledge that you have before you have a new experience. So you already know stuff, and you know that before you have an experience, and that's what helps frame that experience for you. Right? So I know what kinds of plants there are. If I'm out walking in the botanical garden, I already know of various types of plants, then I can recognize them as I walk along. So if there's a bunch of different, very similar plants, but I know the differences, I can pick them out. Other people would just think they're maybe all the same. But since I have a priori knowledge, I'm able to tell the difference between these five plants. A priori.
So it's like a prior knowledge.
Yeah. That's from the Latin. So when we say prior to, a priori. This just means to or toward. So A or AD, I believe, is the.
A meaning like the absence of? Or, like, I don't know, A can mean a lot of things.
Yeah, I'm not sure how easy.
That kind of makes sense, though, because it's without a prior experience, and you're denoting from a theoretical deduction, not from observation. So you don't have a prior, like, physical knowledge of it. You have a theoretical knowledge of it.
Probably
so
it won't be easy for me to just look up A by itself.
Right, well, I mean, like, apolitical, anarchy, I don't know, I'm like looking at it in terms of like A as in like not, you know, like the absence of like apolitical, meaning like you're not political, you know.
In that case, it would be Greek.
Okay.
And the reason, well, and how you can know that is, I know it's confusing, but A in Greek means not.
Yeah.
Right? So this doesn't mean not prior. This
okay.
is from a Latin root that means to the prior condition, right? To the first condition, to the first argument, whatever, to prior, first, and two, right? So that, and then the other one, well, of course, the other one, I'll put that up here, is posterior. After, exactly.
After prior, what is that? Isn't that an oxymoron? After prior?
So this is what comes from.
Okay, so the opposite.
So the one is before, and this is after.
So that's like a physical observation, not just
So, before I went to the botanical garden, I knew those five types of plants, and I could see, oh, that's that one, that's that one, that's that one. Now I know
that at the botanical garden, those five plants are in that bed. That's a posteriori. Posteriori. It's also easy to remember because you sit on your posterior. But you have to be careful when you're saying posteriori. You're not always making a posterior of yourself. So those are, so before and after, they become a technical, in epistemology, theory of knowledge, it becomes a technical expression associated with knowledge before I have an experience of phenomena, and a posteriori is the resulting knowledge that I now have because I've just had another experience. Now, we also have analytic knowledge and synthetic knowledge. So analytic knowledge is the kind of knowledge you have that just comes from analysis of what you already know.
And synthetic is what you make.
Synthetic is new news. It's new. I just learned it.
Well, I know that the synth would be like synthesized to bring together, and then edic meaning the.
Well, so for example, analytic information would be like definitions. So I know what the definition of a horse is, and I will recognize one if I see one. No problem. But so, in any situation that I could be in, if I see a horse for the first time and learn that this is a horse, now because I have learned that, I have seen horses at a farm, maybe even rode one or something. I now know what horses are. So I have a posteriori analytic knowledge of horses. And because of that experience, the next time I go to the horse farm, I now have a priori analytic information. I know what horses are, I've seen them before, now I'm seeing them again.
I thought that a priori came first always, because like...
Ah, well, how did I get the information? I had... Actually, it would start here. I go to the farm, I see horses for the first time as a kid. Having this experience, which is the new experience, because I've had it, so it's past, so I've had this experience. Now I have analytic information. I defined horses by that experience. And now when I go and I have new experiences, I already have that background and I have analytic a priori information. Well, it's now information I have in my head prior to my going to see them again, right? Now, here's what David Hume says you cannot have. You cannot have new information
that you created, right? Synthetic?
Already. You can't already, before you have an experience, have... Yeah, it's logically impossible, right? So this would be knowing already before I have the chance to know it. Is that weird? Well, that be? Well, Yum.
So basically, like, if you've never heard of a horse, then you can't make a, like, sophisticated opinion of a horse. Mm-hmm. Is that what you're trying to say?
Can you say that again?
If you've never been associated with a horse, or seen a horse, or heard of a horse, you can't make a, like, realistic, like, interpretation of it. Is that what this is about?
The first time, say, primitive tribesmen saw horses with riders on them. They didn't know what the heck it was. Right? It scared the crap out of them. They thought that was one animal. Plus it had a sword that was slicing their heads off.
Yeah.
This is not like Sam, who sees the elephants for the first time and says, "Olifants! You know, Frodo, they're olifants!" He's all thrilled, not even noticing that he's being surrounded by a bunch of archers ready to kill the olifants.
So, like, would an example of this be when, like,
I can't give you an example of this. Because Yum says, this is impossible.
Always?
It would be like, knowing ahead of time something that you don't know yet.
But what if somebody told you?
If somebody told me. Well, that in a sense would actually be here, which once I understand it better would be moved over to here and then up to here. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Let's see if I can.
So something told you this horse is a horse farm, but you haven't been to the farm, you've seen the horses yet.
Well, of course, it's more complex when we're thinking in terms of today we have pictures of horses. A lot of people will never see a horse in person, but they see them on TV and cowboy movies and stuff of that sort. So I'm looking at Kant's Prolegomena, page 782. I should highlight this. This is right up at the top, near 260. It says, "I openly confess my recollection of David Hume was the very thing which many years ago first interrupted my dogmatic slumber and gave my investigations in the field of speculative philosophy a quite new direction." But he doesn't think that Hume was understood by anybody. In fact, traditionally we say that Kant's the first that really understood what the implications of Hume's. Hume understood it, and he was surprised no one
understood this?
Yes.
So, when your exam question says, do you think Kant answered Hume successfully, then Kant is basically
answering this question. Can metaphysics exist? Can there be metaphysics? Because Hume is basically saying that metaphysics as a science is an attempt to give a priori synthetic information. But that's impossible. So all metaphysics is a waste of time, which, by the way, is traditional, especially in America. A lot of Americans grow up feeling like philosophy is a total waste of time. And they clump philosophy in metaphysics in that sense. So they're not talking ethics, they're not talking aesthetics, they're not talking logic. They're talking metaphysics. They say philosophy is a waste of time. And it's a Scottish tradition, because Hume, of course, is Scot. In a sense, the common sense tradition feels like metaphysics is a waste of time.
So,
because you're trying to decide what must be the case in order for us to experience anything. And because that requires you to see the thing in itself,
to know if you're right, but you can't, and to understand the nature of the self with seeing this, but you can't. Plus, if you talk about God, which you put up on the top, I usually put God up on the top. You can put him on the bottom, I guess, if you want. Usually God goes up top. He's not part of, or he, she, or it, whatever you call God, or even the lack of death, turns out to be, unless it's phenomenal, you're not actually experiencing anything. So unless God, like, arrives, says, boo, or whatever God would do, right? I'm not experiencing any phenomena that's God. As Hume argues, we're taking all of these kinds of characteristics. I've learned about nice people. God is the nicest person. I've learned about smart people. God is the smartest person. I've learned about powerful people, but God is the powerfulest person. Right? So I'm extrapolating from phenomena I actually have seen, hypothesizing this incredible being, which I have not experienced. Right? So God is outside of phenomena as well. But so, let me see if I can find... So page 782, where he says, you know, David Hume was the very thing which, you know, many years ago interrupted my dogmatic slumber and gave my investigations in the field of speculative philosophy a quite new direction. He says, so I therefore first tried whether Hume's objection could not be put into a general form, which is where this comes from. So as far as I know, Hume doesn't actually arrange it this way, but I soon found that the concept of the connection of cause and effect was by no means the only concept by which the understanding thinks the connection of things a priori, but rather that metaphysics consist altogether of such concepts, all of them. Right? I sought to ascertain their number, and when I had satisfactorily succeeded in this by starting from a single principle, I proceeded to the deduction of these concepts, which I was now certain were not derived from experience.
So, like...
So there are things that we have that are part of our knowledge that don't come from phenomena.
So God is basically like the opposite of phenomena, because rather than being something that we're interpreting but we're not sure if it's real, he's something we can't interpret but we think is real. So it's like the opposite sort of thing.
Well, he's also like the number five. Now, I've seen five things, but the only reason I think of those five things as five things is because I've learned this abstract concept, five, that then I've applied to. So in a way, I can't prove that there are five. That's a belief system, that there are five. I'm you know, fully ensconced in mathematical beliefs. You know, I accept them. And by the way, nobody in my society argues that I'm an idiot because I'm believing in math. Richard Dawkins believes in math. He's not critical of people that believe it. You're a fundamentalist. You're just believing in that because your teachers told you to. Well, yeah.
It's kind of interesting to try to think of math in a different way than like what it is, though. Because wouldn't it kind of be like a natural law sort of thing, though? Even though we did come up with it, like two trees.
How are natural laws any different? Natural laws are faith-based as well. Where do they come from? From Sir Isaac Newton, Galileo, Einstein, Poncelli. No, not Poncelli. Poncelli doesn't teach you that because he makes you grow up thinking that alligators can dance with hippopotami.
But, like, math existed before we, like, developed it and found a way to organize it, like primal, like, humans, you know? Or even
it
animals.
Works.
Yeah,
it
like,
works.
If there's five batches of berries over here and one over there, and I'm a group of bears or something, like, obviously. That's a bad example, but, like, it's... It
bears
does
can count at least up to three.
Yeah. They can... I don't know.
Yeah, most animals can count at least three and then a lot.
Right. It's more abstract than,
yeah.
like, a single unit. It's more
they
can like
prove math with math, too.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's circular reasoning, though. Which is okay. It's the best, actually. Once you've accepted the axioms, it's all circular. But the trouble is you cannot prove the axioms, and that's been proved.
It's been proven that you can't prove it.
That's, it is.
So, was Kant successful in answering Hume?
Well, now that's up to you. I'm still in the dictionary. So, this proves that the axioms of arithmetic are absolutely necessary for you to do arithmetic, but that the axioms of arithmetic cannot be proven as true. Axioms are your faith. You have faith in them.
We
usually can't prove the axioms,
but we all assume to be true, like there's nature truths. We all accept that 1 + 1 = 2, you know, so.
Well, you've been taught that.
Yeah.
From, you know, no one disagrees with it, as far as I know. If they do, we usually throw them in a place where they'll be safe.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't want them to hurt themselves. But it is, it's like trusting that the meanings of our words are what we all agree that they are. But guess what? Those can change over time. But so he's going to argue that this is something we can know to be the case. How do we do it? We have to transcend the limitation of this. Transcendent. So he uses his transcendental method to say that we have all of these categories. Did I draw 12? There should be 12. Plus we have time and space. So for Kant, these are all the categories of understanding, and they're also going to be related to the categories of judgment. That's where we'll pick up on Tuesday. But I didn't need a quiz question. So, what do you think of Rousseau's theory of education? That the best education is no education. That's my one-line summary of it. but basically Emile is an example of you wait until the child is old enough to start asking you questions. When you answer them, you let the child's curiosity direct the education. But if you think about it, at the time, education was rote learning. So it was probably pretty terrible. So they needed something to kind of